I joined the police department because I think that there was some adventure and some excitement, but also to do something that really matters. Mm-hmm. I want to catch bad guys, people that are preying upon people. I'm from Bronx Homicide. I've got a 90 for you for an old case from 1999. God forbid you're on your deathbed tomorrow and you're looking back at your life, and if you did something that mattered, I think that's the most important thing.
In February 2018, CNN gained rare access into the NYPD's Bronx Homicide Unit to follow detectives as they work a decades-old cold case.
Minerliz Soriano was 13 years old. She was still several years away from her prom. She never got to go.
Minerliz Soriano, a seventh grader from the Bronx, was brutally killed February 24th, 1999.
My name is Kimberly Ortiz and went to middle school 135 with Minerliz. She was just so bubbly, so kind. She always had this book with her where she always wrote about poetry.
What do you remember about February 24th, 1999?
Gosh, that date. I remember that date like yesterday. I was the last person who probably saw her alive other than her killer.
Minerliz left school and vanished. And after a grueling citywide search, her body was found 4 days later in a dumpster 2 miles from her home. She'd been strangled.
It was like, you know, Minerliz is dead and they don't know who it was. This killer is still out there. And this person's probably preying on kids our age. Yeah, we were all on edge.
The hardest cases that we deal with as medical examiners are those involving children. What was done with her is something that has been haunting me for the nearly 20 years since that date. There was no really good leads as to who did it.
When we met up with Malcolm Ryman, he was rounding the corner on 31 years of service.
I could have retired 11 and a half years ago. I was eligible to retire and I stayed. I feel this is important work.
James, are you remorseful at all?
During his career, Ryman created a niche for himself, solving some of the hardest cases in the NYPD's history. Serial killers, rapists, and even homicides where bodies were never found. The department hoped fresh eyes would help find Minerliz's killer. It seemed all leads had been exhausted, and the case continued to loom over the Bronx community.
We can't bring her back. We all want to know what happened to her.
It's important. We want to look at her, want to humanize her, remember who we're working for. It's better to have a mountain of material than to start with nothing. As daunting as it is, it's also pure gold in here. It actually displays just how difficult this case is going to be to solve. This is interesting. This is some of the stuff that went to the FBI lab. Here's some of her poetry that she wrote.
Minerliz's diaries were filled with a mix of schoolwork, love notes, even a list of astronomy websites she liked to visit.
It just stays with you, and this was one of them. This was one of them, Minerliz Soriano.
Over the years, dozens of detectives worked this case, and Ryman reached out to many of them and retraced the steps they took 20 years before.
Hey, Barney, it's Malcolm Ryman from Bronx Homicide.
It was a Sunday morning. I was at church. I got a beep. We still had beepers then. They found a dead body in a dumpster over in Co-op City. There was a guy who was kind of a scrounger, so he found a heavy bag. He ripped it open, and there was Minerliz. He saw her face and her head and stuff. So we have her leaving school, getting on the bus, getting off the bus, looking like she was entering her building. The next thing we know, she's found in this dumpster.
I've seen rape homicides before. They're usually messy. But this was like all wrapped up in a bundle, like somebody cared that she was dead.
We're going to go to the location where her body was recovered. And we're going to take a look at these areas, and we're just going to get a feel for the area, see what's around, get a feel for what it looks like.
Dark here.
This would have been all that dark, desolate lot. If it's really late at night, there's not a whole lot going on back then here.
None of those lights would have been there. It's daytime when she's found. Assuming maybe that the crime occurs at her residence, the way the highways are set up, this is really a no-brainer in terms of finding a remote location where you could come.
When detectives found Minerliz's body, she was fully clothed. A crucial clue, though, was discovered on her sweatshirt, traces of semen.
Apparently, the victim used to go around all the apartments in her building doing door-to-door candy sales. Perhaps somebody took an interest in her, an unhealthy interest.
Ryman learned that after reviewing hundreds of old detective notes. The paperwork showed investigators chased hundreds of leads, spoke to numerous witnesses, even took DNA samples from more than a dozen potential suspects. Nothing pointed to who did it. Their work led Ryman to re-examine an original theory that Minerliz may not have been a stranger to her killer.
It seems as if she would have had an unusually high exposure to other residents in that building.
So detectives revisited Minerliz's apartment building.
We knock on every door of the building. We also have a good idea of who was in the building back then, what men were able to be in a sexually active mode in 1999, that were of age to have sex, who could be a possible suspect, and we're getting an idea of who they are, where they are.
So Ryman made a list of former tenants who he didn't get to speak to that day. And then his investigative focus shifted to a newly available DNA technology. Ryman and his lieutenant, who also worked on the case in 1999, wanted to request familial DNA testing.
This was a case we did a lot of work. We had just heard about the familial DNA at one of the training sessions.
New York approved the use of familial DNA testing in 2017. It allows police to identify possible suspects in a case by their connection with male relatives who were convicted of a crime and in the state's DNA database. To date, the state has only okayed its use for 35 cases. It would take time, possibly years, and a lot of work for the state to even consider using it in Minerliz's case. For Ryman, time was the issue. After 31 years, the decorated detective was ready to retire.
Gonna have to let it go and pass it on and pass the torch. Tough to do.
In November 2021, 3 years after Ryman handed in his badge, nearly 23 years since Minerliz's killing, the city announced it made an arrest.
Minerliz was not just a grim statistic or a case number. She was a vibrant child who should be with us today, enjoying life.
A grand jury indicted 49-year-old Joseph Martinez on 2 counts of second-degree murder. He pleaded not guilty. He has no prior criminal history. Through his attorney, Martinez says he's innocent. Martinez was identified with the help of this team in the NYPD's forensic unit. After the Homicide Bureau requested familial DNA in 2018, Chief Emmanuel Katronakis took on the laborious duty of ensuring that the case met the strict criteria that the state requires for an application. It took 2 years for New York State's crime lab to come back with a familial DNA hit.
That was the moment that made the difference. Like, the case is going to be solved.
The familial DNA hit gave detectives the name of a convicted offender found in the state's DNA database. This means the forensic team would be looking for someone related to that person as possibly being Minerliz's killer. To help narrow down the possibilities, detectives formed a family tree and identified 5 male relatives of that offender.
We look at their ages, we look at the locations where they're residing, we look at the criminal history of the individuals.
That helped eliminate 2 of the men who were too young at the time of the crime. Investigators were then left with 3, who they determined to be sons of the convicted offender. Taking a closer look at the evidence, detectives realized one of them, Martinez, lived in Minerliz's building when the murder happened. They collected a discarded DNA sample from him, and police say results came back with a direct match.
There's only one individual that deposited his DNA on her front shirt. That is unequivocal.
The city says this is the first cold case solved by using familial DNA.
what happens with this new type of technology is you go from a list of 43 people to one.
That big crater that you saw right in the middle of the moon, that's that crater right there.
Martinez, who was 27 years old at the time of the murder, also goes by Jupiter Joe. He gave sidewalk astronomy classes. Videos of him encouraging kids and adults to see the stars through his telescope are online.
Astronomy, stars, and everything she was interested in is something that's our suspect is interested in. He's on the internet going around talking about it, so there's a connection there.
And detectives discovered another connection. Old case notes from 1999 showed Martinez told police he'd seen Minerliz around their apartment complex getting mail and selling candy. When Martinez was questioned in late November and denied any physical contact with Minerliz, detectives say that's when they knew he was lying, ultimately sealing the case against him.
He was actually fifth on the list of individuals that I wanted to look at and talk to.
What does that say to you?
Says we were heading in the right direction. These cases are so difficult to do, and there are so many setbacks and dead ends. To see that this guy is going to stand in a courtroom and face justice, it's an incredible gratification.
Just to see the person brought in prison is good enough for me.
Minerliz Soriano, a bubbly girl from the Bronx. She daydreamed about love, rainbows, and the stars. There's no way she could have known traces of her life would one day be in boxes on a detective's desk. Her smiling school picture, a reminder of who they were working for.
I hope that she sees all the people that cared, all the people that put in so much effort over so many years, eating meals off the dashboard of a car, and that she knows she wasn't forgotten.
She was just 13, deserving of the life she imagined.
I hope she's smiling at us.